Our members, we will continue with our presentation notes for this morning, and I now invite the Honorable Naiqama Lalabalavu.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. The acting Prime Minister, members of the Cabinet, leader of the opposition, and fellow honorable members. I also rise this afternoon to make my contribution regarding the debate on the appropriation bill that is before this August House. In so doing, I will making my speech on probably two or three observations. These observations have kind of made me feel that this is a budget that is that doesn't have that investor confidence. So apart from that, as previously indicated by my honorable colleagues on the other side of the house, this is a budget that is inclusive and so on and so forth. But in terms of the word inclusive, as a speaker, I beg to differ with the description that the other side of the house is making of this appropriation bill. And from the outset, I'd like to quote from page 296 of today's photo of the uncorrected version, especially paragraph 4, and that is to do with Honorable Bimar Prasad's speech yesterday, and I'd like to quote from the fourth paragraph, which says, the national budget is a central political process. It is not only a process which lays down the expenditure and income of the government, but provides a platform for a longer-term vision of our country, political credibility, and confidence from the future. And of course, that to me is how I'd like to suggest we should observe and see this appropriation way. It is not just the income and expenditure face of it, but more to do with the way to reach the people and the government as a whole. And as such, Madam Speaker, from the outset as well, I'd like to dwell on this level of inclusiveness as responded by my colleagues on the other side of the house. And I'd like to take us back to a recent trip made by the Honourable Prime Minister to Punavale, especially to Punavale, when he landed in Bua. This was immediately after the swearing-in of members of this August House. And what was reported, has been said by the Honourable Prime Minister, is that I will try and think carefully as to how development would be considered under my government. Few people who know him, something along those lines, let's say. Because you did not vote for me. And don't you know? As I've indicated from the Honorable Bimar Prasad's outline of what the budget is, I think it's important that I make a rebuttal on this. Not only in my position with my fellow colleagues from the North, that in this August House, by winning our seats, so to speak, but also as citizens of this country and taxpayers as well. This is where the people citizenry issue comes into play. I'd like from the Chair, to as well, Madam Speaker, I informed this Honourable House that for us in the north, including Laos, to make up the Tobacco Confederacy, we've been around for quite some time. Our existence predates government. We've embraced Christianity, and that has molded our life. Even we believe that the Holy Spirit manifested itself, saving the north, from Fiji, from the conquest of the Pope in the late 1860s. And just this year we celebrate, the Catholics celebrate, 150 years anniversary. All of the coming into Fiji of Catholicism. Madam Speaker, the north of Tobacco Confederacy has produced refugees. Former Governor General and President of the country, former Prime Ministers, former Army Commanders, former Ministers, senior government officials, you name it. Some are even on the other side of the house. And never have we acted this way in taking oath of our duty of the first house, that we will think twice about people who never voted for us when it comes to development. I don't know where our Prime Minister was coming from, but all I want to say, we are in the other head, as a traditional leader. We, or probably a biblical verse that goes like this, man does not live on bread alone. As taxpayers, as citizens of this country, come with me. But we will live. We will continue to live and do our duties for this country as required, especially in this August House. Hello, sweetheart. There's a saying. What goes around comes around. And I'd like to repeat that. What goes around comes around. The Fiji First Party is one of them. I like to hear the words, the flowery words they use. This is the only party, this is the first party. Everything is first. But Madam Speaker, this is the Honorable Prime Minister, Honorable Ben Barama's first party. It's not here. We understand it is, he has duties to perform. But again,
yeah, Madam Speaker, I raised the voice of point of order. I think a point of order similarly to that you have ruled on the suggestion of the 11th member of the opposition. With regards to relevance and making reference directly to individuals, I have been sitting here listening to the initial address of the Honourable Member. And I think it has, apart from the issue of inclusiveness, I think he has dwelt outside of the issue that we are debating in terms directly, the issues relating directly to the budget. So, I would just like to raise that.
Thank you. I would like to remember to maintain the role that we are creating from addressing the person directly. In this case, addressing the Prime Minister directly. But in general, in your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Perhaps if I may qualify why I am saying this in my opening address, it's because this is to do with his government. That's why I'm mentioning his name, it's not here. It's Fiji's First Party. This is Fiji's First Party. First budget in this August hour. It's not here simply for the reason that this is decided. That's more important than this. And secondly, Madam Speaker, when it comes to the Committee of Supply, when we talk about F1, we will be raising issues regarding the Office of the President and NEC, and we have questions to raise. Given that we know, I don't know, this amount is very, privy to information that what is happening out there, and here we will be talking about some heading that reflects on the office of His Excellency the President. Those are the reasons why I'm raising this, Madam Speaker. It's not about anything else. But apart from that, Madam Speaker, as I've indicated, what goes around comes around. And because we believe in a living God, and that has taken us through more difficult times than this. Madam Speaker, let me now turn to the subject that the Honourable Prime Minister for Finance has included in his budget speech regarding the development of bombing, and also that of the Honourable Prime Minister, which they often use during the elections to hoodwink the Fijian landowners. Madam Speaker, the case of land swap or exchange in particular, is the related to Denarau and more. If the Honourable Minister of Finance is to be believed, the exchange of land in these two developments were illegal and not in the landowners' interest. At the early stages of Denarau Island, a company known as EIA International Corporation, Madam Speaker, was the developer of substantial parcels of land for islands surrounding and owned Denarau Island. It belongs to the three abusers of land. The title to the land around Denarau Island comprised of freehold, state land, and native. EIE, through the manager of Mr. Andrew Thompson, who is now Lodala, had invested a substantial sum of money to develop on the island to this side of the Pacific region, a first-class integrated destination resort which will be unique to Fiji and the Pacific as a whole. It stands there, manifesting itself in the Pacific as one of the jewels of our tourism development in this region. At the time of development, due to the various land titles that existed on and around the island, it was strongly and firmly envisaged that there was a need to rationalize and organize such parcels of land to provide a simple, coherent structure, beneficial to all parties. The concept of recognizing the title to the parcels of land has and had become known as the land swap or land exchange. Land exchange between native landowners, the state, and freeholders was nothing new, nor radical, Madam Speaker, since the enabling legislation then was the Native Land Amendment Ordinance of 1895. And through the years, Madam Speaker, this has evolved. Maybe it's not part of Section 9 of the Native Land Trust Act. So in the case of Denarau and Mobi, the end result, hopefully Mobi, the end result is a resort development of significant investment with long-term benefits for both the landowners and the country. Madam Speaker, the fact that the very same critics of our efforts to get Mobi going with a land swap that did not deny either part less than they gave have themselves in recent weeks, especially our Prime Minister, restarted the Mombi Bay development. Using the very same land swap they criticized us for before the elections, and should make it clear as who is or who was misleading the people. The two major developments were not only land swaps done, and both the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister did have information and knowledge of these landslots, but chose not to refer to them when attacking us. especially during the campaign, and even in the Honorable Minister's finance meeting speech in this August House. Some of the well-known cases of exchanges of swap of land between native owners and freeholders using the provisions of the Native Land Amendment Ordinance 1895 as follows. Mata del Tambudor, Lombasa, NDFSC, NLTB reference 4/9/1485. The second one is just some of the examples mentioned. In Matangalip na Magulungo Sierra, and if you the reference and NLTB reference is 4/2/8, and the case file is C/19497. Native land owners and the Roman Catholic Church. Regarding, this is recorded in NLTB reference 8/13/1. Even Matangali Gelgel, Dr. Tapa, Watu, and the FSC Sansa Duru, number one, Madam Speaker. The intention of the Speaker is not merely to accommodate the wishes of both parties. More importantly, to ensure that the land swaps or exchanges were at the best interest of the native owners, and which reaffirms Section 4.1, Subsection 1 of the Native Land Trust Act 3.4, which provides that the control of native land shall be vested in the board. All such land shall be administered for the benefit of the Fijian owners. Madam Speaker, may I now take us to the supremacy. There is a significant reference in the budget to the sugar industry, and as always, it is difficult getting a fix on exactly where we are with this ailing enterprise, the backbone of our economy. Tourism is the number one income earner. But we all understand it's unstable. It does depend on political class of the country at any point. If you listen to the old Prime Minister and his Foreign Secretary, you will get the impression that the industry is on the way up. Sounds good, but the Honorable Minister of Finance has said, in his budget, TCTS is very good. That means 8, probably 10 tons of sugar to 1 ton of sugar cane. But again, what the Honorable Minister failed to explain as well was how the industry has been struggling all these years to reach where it was before in terms of the overall sugar production, sugar cane production. Maybe the Honorable Members on my side would be elaborating more on this, but I'd like to quote from a news report on November 10th, the Fair Trade Development. And the manager concerned, Mr. Mohamed Adib, painted a picture which revealed a real crisis. Fiji will have to produce probably 3.5 to 3.6 million tons of sugar annually if it is to survive. Last year, Fiji production was on. Was 1.8 million tons. He said Fiji had to double its production in the next 3 years to be viable. He also revealed that out of the 80,000 acres of cane land, only half was used for farming, and this was not done effectively. I read from the Honorable Minister and from the Minister of from the Honorable Prime Minister that works are being done to help improve it. But again, for this budget, we need to inform the nation that the backbone of our economy is tragic. And we need to put all our hands together. The interesting thing about this industry, Madam Speaker, is that soon after the coup, when the coup was carried out, they were doing their issue of the sugar industry being highly politicized. So highly politicized. But then, Madam Speaker, the industry was producing almost 300,140 tons. That was without, that was during the NFU and the Fiji Rose Association and all that. We have been labeled as being politicians and heavily involved in the sugar industry. But when they were pushed out, the production fell heavily to 1,106 tons in 2018. Just lately this is coming. It will go beyond 180,000 tons. Madam Speaker, we need to get serious about how our sugar industry is being run. And we need to do that now. And we need to do that now. I request if you may listen for a couple of minutes. My time has left. I take point on this.